So today the class is on mucogingival surgery. From this class we would like you to know the definition of mucogingival and perioplastic surgery, outline all the perioplastic procedures, classify recession, discuss the various perioplastic procedures followed in periodontics, use the basic knowledge of perioplastic surgery while drafting a treatment plan, explain the indications, outcomes, complications of perioplastic procedures. So the contents include introduction, mucogingival surgery and perioplastic surgery, what is the difference, gingival augmentation apical to the recession area. So we'll be discussing about the free gingival autografts, apically positioned flap and the pedicle grafts in the edentulous area. Then a little about augmentation in the edentulous ridge, crown lengthening, phrenectomy and phrenotomy, surgical exposure of impacted canine by forced eruption, and then we'll finish it with conclusion. So to start with, the term mucogingival surgery was initially introduced in literature by Friedman. This term compiles the surgical procedures for the correction of relationship between the gingiva and the oral mucous membrane. So before we go into the abnormalities, I would like to stress upon the normal features. So as you all know, this is the free gingival margin followed by the attached gingiva. So it was put forward by Goldman, a theory where called tissue barrier concept, where he told that a dense collagenous band of tissue retards the inflammation from spreading to the underlying bone. So which means this, the attached tissue, attached gingiva has to be a little dense and collagenous, and sufficient amount has to be present. If not, it might result in problems. So these problems are discussed in this mucogingival therapy. So the problems include decreased amount of attached gingiva, the frenum interfering with the marginal gingiva and a shallow vestibule. The 1996 World Workshop in Clinical Periodontics renamed mucogingival surgery as perioplastic surgery, a term put forward by Miller. This includes the periodontal plastic prosthetic corrections, crown lengthening, ridge augmentation, aesthetic correction of coverage of a denuded root surface, reconstruction of papilla, aesthetic surgical correction around the implants, and surgical exposure of unerupted teeth for orthodontics. So what is the difference between mucogingival therapy and perioplastic surgery? So perioplastic surgery, the term is purely a surgical term, which is defined as a surgical procedure performed to correct, eliminate anatomic, developmental or traumatic deformities of the gingiva or the alveolar mucosa. This term includes only the surgical procedure of the huge term, that is the mucogingival therapy. Whereas mucogingival therapy is a broader term that includes the non-surgical procedures such as papillary reconstruction by means of orthodontic therapy or restorative therapy. So it is better to be explained with an example here. So here you have a black triangle. In other words, the papilla has recessed here. So in this case, we have done a surgical procedure where we have placed the PRF into this area and we have corrected the black triangle over here in this area. But here, since there is more amount of black triangle and surgical therapies will not help in this particular case, so we had taken the help of a prosthodontist to create a processes like this and just place it over these black triangles so that they get eliminated and he has a beautiful smile. So in other words, surgical therapy means it's perioplastic surgery, and any other therapy which includes both the orthodontic or restorative therapy comes under the term mucogingival therapy. So we have three problems, as I told. There is problems associated with the attached gingiva, problems associated with the shallow vestibule, and problems associated with an aberrant frenulum. So we'll see each of these. So first of all, problems associated with attached gingiva. So the ultimate goal of mucogingival therapy is to create creation or widening of an attached gingiva around the tissue and the implants. So why is this needed? So there is a concept called as tissue barrier concept. Which was given by Goldman, it terms that a dense collagenous band of connected tissue retards or obstructs the spread of inflammation better than a loose fiber of arrangement of alveolar mucosa. So in other words, it means that increasing the width of attached gingiva helps in achieving an adequate tissue barrier, thus limiting the recession as a result of inflammation. The rationale behind all this surgical procedure is that there should be at least a minimum width of attached gingiva for the optimal health to be
maintained. A vital zone of
attached gingiva is also needed around the teeth that serve as abutments for fixed or removable partial dentures, as well as in ridge areas in relation to dentures. So this is collectively under the term preprosthetic periodontal surgical procedures. Now this widening of the attached gingiva mainly has three main motives. That is, it can enhance the plaque removal around the gingival margin, it can improve the aesthetics and reduce the inflammation around the restored teeth. Problems associated with shallow vestibule, that is the second problem. Gingival recession, generally what it does is that it tends to displace the gingival margin in an apical direction. So here you can see the gingival recession. It has reduced it to the, it has moved the margin to the apical direction. So because of which there is a shallow vestibule here. So with minimum shallow vestibule, you will not be able to place your brush here and do your oral hygiene properly. So with minimal vestibular depth, proper hygiene procedures are jeopardized. So this tends to be a mucogingival problem. Problems associated with aberrant frenulum. A frenulum or a frenum that encroaches the margin of the gingiva may interfere with plaque removal, and tension on this frenum may tend to open the sulcus on either sides. In these cases, a surgical removal of this frenum is indicated. So whenever there is going to be a lack of attached gingiva after you do your therapy, if you find there is going to be a progressive gingival recession or there is going to be an inflammation, so if your answer is yes for these, then obviously you need to do a mucogingival therapy. Answer is no for this, but you need certain aesthetic considerations, then you can go in for mucogingival therapy. If no aesthetic considerations are there, this is not indicated. So there are two surgical procedures related to these therapies. So one is the gingival augmentation apical to the area of the recession, and one is the gingival augmentation coronal to the area of the recession, otherwise known as the root coverage procedure. So in this case, a graft, either a pedicle or a free graft, is placed on the recipient bed apical to the recessed area. So here you can see that the attached gingiva is very less here. So free gingival graft has been taken from the palate and placed apical to this area. So we have not considered the above recessed area. We have placed in these areas so that the width of the attached gingiva is increased. So you can see clearly that it is placed below this to increase the width of the attached gingiva. Whereas gingival augmentation coronal to the recession, where it is the graft is placed covering the denuded root surface. So here there is a recession on all the teeth, and on this teeth you can see an alloderm being placed, and how the recession has totally it is totally come to class 1. So such a procedure, it comes under root coverage, and we'll be seeing it in the next two classes, what are the procedures along with it. So this class we are mainly confined to gingival augmentation apical to the recession area, that is for increasing the width of the attached gingiva through procedures such as free gingival autograft, free connective tissue autograft, and the apical position flap. So first we'll start with free gingival autograft. This was a technique which was given by John in the year 1963. So these are the steps where we would ask you to prepare the recipient site. So here you can see there is a clinical picture which shows that the attached gingiva for this particular area is very little. So it was aimed to increase the width of the attached gingiva. So we start with incising at the mucogingival junction to the desired depth. Then blend the incision on both the sides with the existing mucogingival line. Outline the area with two vertical incisions so that it is confined to that particular area, and extend the incision to twice the desired width of the attached gingiva. So you can see in the clinical picture that if I want just 2 mm of attached gingiva width to be increased, I need to pull in more, that is 4 mm of recipient site has to be prepared. Then following which, you're going to separate the flap and you're going to suture the flap to the underlying periosteum here so that it doesn't overlap. So this area is being sutured to the underlying periosteum so that it doesn't overlap in this area. And then you're going to make a tin foil template of the recipient side. This I'll tell you the use in the next slide why we are making this. So step two is to obtain the graft from the donor site. So the ideal donor site, it would be a palatal area where partial thickness graft can be used. So the procedures for this is that you're going to make a shallow incision with the template outline. So you can find how much material or graft is really required with the help of this template outline, and elevate the edge and hold it with the help of tissue forceps. Continue to separate the graft with the help of a blade, and then the graft is removed and the palate is sutured for the hemostasis. You can see the clinical picture after the graft is removed. So all the time, a proper thickness is an important thing for survival of the graft. It has to be as thin as possible to permit the ready diffusion of the nutritive fluid from the recipient site, and it should be essential for the immediate post-transplant period also. That is, it should be thick enough in that area also, but it should not be so thin that it should necrose and expose the recipient site, or it should not be so thick that it gets jeopardized. Excessive tissue that separates it from the new circulation and the nutrients. Deeper wound at the donor site with the possibility of injuring the major palatal arteries is another problem if the graft material is going to be very thick. So the ideal thickness would be around 1 to 1.5. So you can see that along with the graft, there has been certain glandular or adipose tissue. So this can be removed before and the donor tissue is prepared from the palate. Now you're going to transfer and immobilize the graft to the recipient site. So by this time there could be excess clot which is formed, so remove them and position the graft and adapt it firmly to the recipient site. Dead space would have been formed in the area between the graft and the underlying periosteum. So this dead space may impair the vascularization and jeopardize the graft again. So suture the graft at the lateral borders to the periosteum and secure it in position. The graft must be immobilized and any movement can interfere in its healing. So here you can see a situation where they have again placed the free gingival graft, and the width of attached gingiva has been increased, and the patient can maintain this area very good. Now there are certain variations for free gingival graft because the amount of graft which is obtained, that is the donor tissue which is obtained from palate, it's very small. So authors have done procedures so that they could make this existing graft a little more longer or sufficient enough to use for the large number of teeth. So the first technique was by an accordion technique, which is by Ritterschack, where he had done a procedure where he expanded the graft by means of an alternate incision in the opposite sides of the graft. So the next technique by hand was the strip technique. So you can see the image for the strip technique where the palatal graft donor tissue was given, and this is being cut into two so that you have two or three strips of donor tissues, which is around 3 to 5 mm wide and long. This covers the entire to a length of the recipient side by placing it side to side to form one donor tissue getting sutured to a large number of recipient site, and this results in rapid healing of the donor site. Same way, you can do a combination technique where a strip of tissue from the palate thick enough of around 3 to 4 mm is taken. The superficial portion consists of the epithelium and connective tissue, and the deeper portion consists of connective tissue alone. So these are two graft materials, so these can be placed side by side. The advantage here is that the minimal donor site wound can be done by obtaining two donor sites from one site itself. So that is the advantage of this technique. So coming on to the indications, increased width of attached gingiva, forms new functional attached gingiva and completely absent gingival area, deepens the oral vestibule for covering exposed roots for ridge augmentation purposes. Coming on to the advantages, high success rate for increasing the width of the attached gingiva, applicable for multiple teeth and it is a simple procedure. The disadvantages would include presence of two wound areas, the unfavorable color match, rough texture of the gingiva, limitations connected with the extent of donor area, which restricts the area of gingival augmentation just to 3 or maximum 4 teeth. Now the second procedure, that is the apocalypotian flap. So here and so before going into the procedure, I would like you all to go through the classification of flaps once and introduction to the periodontal surgery classes once. So that is easier if you, the present techniques are easier if you understand those. So to start with, an internal bevel incision is made just 1 mm from the crust of the gingiva, and this is directed to the underlying crust of the bone, and followed by which you have the crevicular incision which is made. An initial elevation of the flap is done, and then the interdental incisions are performed. Vertical incisions can be made if the if needed beyond the mucogingival junction, after which the area, if you need a split thickness flap, it is elevated using a sharp Bartpacker blade to split it, leaving a layer of connective tissue below on the periosteum and on the bone area. If you want a full thickness flap, then a blunt dissection with the help of periosteal elevator is being done. So next, coming on to the procedures. So this wedge of interdental tissue is being removed with the help of a curette, and the flap is then displaced apically. So you're placing a little apically, and then the sutures are placed. In case if it is going to be a partial thickness flap, you're going to place a direct loop suture. If it is going to be a full thickness flap, as in this case, you're going to make a sling suture around the tooth for support. And after 1 week, the dressing is removed. You can see the clinical pictures here, where you have increased amount of attached gingiva. So the indications for this, there is an increase of attached gingiva in areas with narrow attached gingival sites. Examination of pockets that extends beyond the mucogingival junction with narrow attached gingiva. Crown lengthening, this technique can be used, but strictly contraindicated in thin gingival areas, lack of carotenoid gingiva at gingival margin, narrow oral vestibule, extremely thin alveolar process, extensive osseous surgery required, deep intrabony defects needing regeneration, periodontal pocket elimination and width of attached gingiva increase with one treatment. Clinical crown can be extended while biologic width is gained. Disadvantages: technically demanding, danger of penetrating the flap during the incision, necrosis leading to severe damage to the blood vessels, and delayed healing is another thing. So the third technique, that is edentulous area in the using the pedicle graft. So pedicle is a term where the parent or the base area is present. The graft is just turn to the other side, that is the same graft is being used to the adjacent teeth. So coming on to step one, so here you can see that a 15 BP blade is being used to make a V-shaped incision. This doesn't involve the furcation area necessarily, but it can go far enough apically to include any pockets. A partial thickness flap is planned here. So you give oblique incisions are made then straight so that it can permit a rotated flap. So the gingival recession is in this area, or otherwise the attached gingiva is less in this area. So around this we carry on the procedures. Step 2, the incision is extended along the crust of the edentulous area and a full thickness flap is planned. In case if there is going to be inadequate attached gingiva, then the palatal aspect can also be included to increase the area of the keratinized gingiva. So step 3, where the pedicle is dissected with the help of 15 BP blade moving in an apical coronal direction. So once it is split, it is reflected from the underlying bone, and it is from the use of the scalpel. Step 5, you can see that the flap is, after the reflection, is beveled out and it is fixed to the adjacent portion. So the area of interest, it is fixed to that portion, and the sutures are being placed. So the procedure, that is augmentation of the edentulous ridges. So here, bone extraction or bone resorption is always found when the tooth is extracted. This is a problem especially in anterior teeth, resulting in anesthetic long ponting if placed on narrow hollowed out ridges. Seibert has classified these ridge defects. So here I would like to tell you beforehand itself that if I am telling as buccolingual, it means the width of this area, and apicocoronal means the height of this area. So the class 1 where there is a buccolingual loss of tissue, that is the width is lost with a normal ridge height in the apicocoronal direction. 2 where the height is lost, that is apicocoronal loss of tissue with a normal ridge width in the buccolingual dimension. 3 the combination of buccolingual and apicocoronal loss of tissue resulting in normal height and width. So this can be corrected by use of grafts, soft tissue grafts itself. So to start with class 1 defect where there is little amount of width present, so the gingival graft is being placed and you can see that the healing is being done. So after which the processes, the preparation was done and the processes was given. Class 2, you can see black triangles in between. The patient was unsatisfied with it and therefore a gingival graft was placed and the graft, the processes was placed against it. The gingiva grew around it, resulting in a very easy way of obtaining the aesthetics here. So here is a procedure where augmentation, both the it's a class 3 where both the width as well as the height is not present. So the flap was open and then to obtain sufficient amount of place, the underlying cancellous bone is being helped removed with the help of a trephine burr, and the trephine burr has taken off the grafts. The graft material has been taken out, that is the autogenous graft, and along with this the grafts, all our grafts has been placed inside this area and GTR has been placed around it and suture. So you can see that there has been a height increase as well as a width increase with the help of these techniques. This next procedure is crown lengthening. This was introduced by D.W. Cohen, a procedure that employs combination of tissue reduction or removal, osseous surgery and or orthodontic for tooth exposure. So why is this done? It is to increase the clinical crown height which is lost due to caries, fracture or wear, to assess the subgingival caries, to assess the perforation in the coronal third of the root, to relocate the margins of restoration that are impinging on the biologic width, and then aesthetics. So before going on into the procedure, I would like you to know what is biologic width. So biologic width is the sum of the junctional epithelium, that is from here to here, and the connective tissue attachment, that is from here till here. So total of which it is 2.04. Supposing if your crown placement has infringed this particular area, that is you are placing your crown margin in this area, then it might lead to gingival recession, loss of connective tissue and further bone resorption. So there are certain procedures for this crown lengthening. So if you find there is sufficient width of attached gingiva but you need to lengthen the crown of the teeth, then you are going for apically pushing flap or gingivectomy procedure. If there is insufficient width of attached gingiva with thick marginal bone, going for apically pushing flap. If there is a thick gingiva, then going for APF partial thickness. If it is thin along with loss of attached gingiva, then going for free gingival graft with full thickness apically pushing flap. So generally it is recommended that the amount of tooth exposed above the osseous crest must be at least 4 mm for a stable dentogingival or a biologic width to permit good tooth preparation, which leads in adequate marginal placement and good marginal seal. So as I told you, there are two procedures which are involved in crown lengthening, either by means of gingivectomy or by means of apically pushing flap. So here I could see that there is more amount of gingival sulcus depth, so I remove off this upper part and I can clinically lengthen this crown. So this is by means of gingivectomy, or I can place it apically pushing place it down by apically repositioning it. So here above the bone I have 2 mm, So if I need to have more amount of the crown, I can remove a still more of bone in this area, and then you can have a total of 3 mm. So this can, and during healing, you're going to place the flap a little apically, resulting in the procedure that is apically portion. So here is a condition where you with the road accident, the patient has lost his teeth. So after the reflection, we could see the teeth were good. So the with the help of the burr, the bone was trimmed away. So here you can see the pictures, and then it was apically placed with the help of the sutures. So after the healing, you can see the tooth normally present, and then the process is being given. So the next procedure is phrenectomy or phrenotomy. Depending upon the extent of attachment of fibers, phrena has been classified as by Plasac as mucosal. So here you can see a condition where the phrenum only is there present in the alveolar mucosal area. The second one is gingival, it has encroached into the gingival area. The third one is papillary, it is present touching the papillary area. And the fourth one is papilla penetrating, which is too much between the tooth, resulting in spaces. So what happens, there is going to be increased amount of pull from the phrenum. There is a close proximity of the muscle attachments and the phrena, resulting in tensional pull. Retraction of the mucosal margin would have been possible, resulting in pocket formation, initiation of the inflammatory process, resulting in proliferation of the junctional epithelium. So there is a renewed extension of the pathologic process if the phrenectomy is not done. So the term phrenectomy includes complete removal of the phrenum, complete removal of the phrenum including its attachment and the underlying bone, whereas the term phrenotomy means relocating the phrenal attachment so as to create a zone of attached gingiva between the gingival margin and phrenum. So if I'm having a penetrating phrenum like this, I'm just going to remove this and place in the adjacent teeth as of this, so that it can be helpful. Next, coming on to lingual phrenectomy. So here you do have so normal, it is attached, that is the phrenum is attached from underneath of the tongue to the floor of the mouth. Whereas in case of ankyloglossia, there is a lack of minimal lingual phrenum or frenulum that is attached to the apex of the tongue, so that it is the tongue has very limited movement. So we can go for phrenectomy by placing the hemostat and cutting it with the help of scalpel below and above, and then opening the phrenum, relieve it for the patient. The last procedure, that is surgical exposure of the impacted canine for forced eruption by orthodontic extrusion. So here there is an impacted canine underneath. As per the requirements of by the orthodontist, this canine has to be removed out. So you can see the preoperative IOPA here. With the help of BB blade, the soft tissues were removed, and then we have reached the tooth area, which is there beneath the bone. And then this area, the bracket has been placed so that the orthodontic procedure can be carried out. So in short, the criteria for selection of these techniques include surgical site free of plaque, calculus and inflammation, adequate blood supply to the donor tissue, anatomy of the recipient and donor sites, stability of the grafted tissue to the recipient site, and minimal trauma to the surgical sites. So I would like to conclude by telling that blood supply is the most significant concern for the surgical procedure. A major complicating factor is the avascular root surface. The formation of vascularity is based on the growth molecules such as VEGF and cellular migration, proliferation and differentiation. As tissue engineering techniques improve, the success and predictability of mucogingival surgery should dramatically increase. Surgical techniques are solely to increase the width and thickness of the keratinized tissue. These are the most predictable periodontal procedures which are being done. Critical analysis of the newly presented techniques should guide our constant evaluation towards better clinical procedures.